This is Whitley Strieber, and this is Dreamland. You've reached the edge of the world. One thing that's often met with skepticism when you sit down and talk about UFOs, aliens, alien abductions, and so forth, is the idea of hybrids, human-alien hybrids. Any biologist will tell you, oh, that would be completely impossible because their DNA would be so different from ours. Don't count on it. Yvonne Smith is with us, and James Lowe, they work together. Yvonne graduated from the California Hypnosis Motivation Institute in 1991 and is a certified hypnotherapist, one of the great experts in this field. She has founded an organization called Close Encounter Research Organization, CERO, in 1992. They have monthly meetings in California to this day, and we'll tell you about those in just a minute. She has very extensively experienced. She started out working with Bud Hopkins and Dr. David Jacobs. I'm sure she still does work with Dr. Jacobs. She has had so many appearances on television and radio. There are too many to count. And Jim works with her. He has a background in political science and the law, but is now also extending in his skills, organizational skills, and his research abilities into this field. And we're very thankful for that. I'd like to welcome both of you to Dreamland today.
Thank you so much for having us, Whitley.
Thank you very much.
Well, it's a real pleasure. And your book, Chosen, is an extraordinary book. I wouldn't call it exactly a real pleasure, though. That's not exactly what we're dealing with here. And, you know, I had many years of difficulty between me and Bud Hopkins that I don't want to belabor, but suffice to say that the reality was not that I was somehow a buddy of these guys. I was going through the same things, and Ann were going through the same things that everybody else goes through, including hybrid experiences. The last one I had was a few weeks ago when one of these things showed up while I was at a meeting and blew out the electronics on two cars that were my car and the car right beside it while we were at the meeting. And so that's where the host is coming from today. I'm not going to be asking you the usual questions. We're going to go a little deeper, and let's start right now. What I want to do is to work into it this way. And Yvonne, if you can start first, let us know when you first began to realize that something like a hybrid program even existed.
Oh, gosh. Way back. Well, of course, I studied with Bud Hopkins. And he would discuss some of his cases with me. And, you know, of course, back then, being such a novice and to hear about what women and men were going through, being shown these very strange, almost sickly looking babies was really difficult to absorb during that time. But now, of course, over the years, I've been doing this 25 years, there's no doubt in my mind that this program, this hybridization program, has been going on for a very long time, and I feel it's very central to the abduction phenomenon.
People keep reporting that the babies are brought back to them. In other words, the baby is lost, and then the baby is shown to them. There's thousands of reports like that. There's lots of them in your book, even. And why is that?
There's no doubt in my mind that this program, this hybridization program, has been going on for a very long time, and I feel it's very central to the abduction phenomenon.
Well, I do, too, and this is why. Ann and I experienced a miscarriage. She did not see anything in the room when it happened, but I did.
I saw what I can't, quite frankly, can safely describe as the most horrifying looking things I have ever seen in my life. Mm-hmm. In standing in the room just moments before the miscarriage occurred in the dead of the night. I never told her about them because I just didn't have the heart.
Mm-hmm.
About 3 or 4 months later, we were shown a baby. We were leaving our house, going to dinner, and we were in the garage in the basement. And then the next thing we knew, we were on the road, 45 minutes late for the reservation, and the three of us, our son was with us, were talking about babies, and we didn't know why.
Mm-hmm.
Once again, I left it at that. Then, 4 or 5 years later, this very strange, extraordinarily disturbed and agonized little man showed up living in the woods behind our house. And all of our listeners, my listeners, know this story. I'll just be very brief.
Mm-hmm.
He lived back there. He could not stand you to get near him. If Ann and I, by the time, this time we were living alone in the house, would go skinny dipping in our very private swimming pool, he would run up and down in the woods behind the house, gasping and breaking sticks and making noise to drive us inside. He didn't want us outside like that. He was very upset about it. This is the time in which we lost our house and we had to move to Texas, mm-hmm. where we had a little condo that we could live in. He moved with us before a few weeks had passed. There he was, standing outside the condo at night. He was living in the condo, another condo next door, with two men who were horrifying beyond words. They literally radiated evil. He wandered around the condo complex in such a way that it disturbed people, and they called Texas Social Services on the theory that he was a feral child. I set up automatic lights where he was hiding, which would turn on anytime somebody entered that area. And the next thing I knew, he went stalking off down the street, and I never saw him again. And 2 days later, the men who had been living ferally, they were squatters in somebody's empty condo, went around that place trying to sell the owner of the condo's furniture to the rest of us. And then they left, and the experience ended. Now,
Whitley, what did he look like?
He looked like he was, at first, when I first saw him in the woods, I thought he was a boy. He smoked mm-hmm. constantly, like a schizophrenic, like a person with mental schizophrenia. They will smoke constantly because it calms them down.
Mm-hmm.
And when I got close to him, he looked more like a sort of weathered child, I would say. He looked like about an 11-year-old who was something was wrong with his skin. He looked older than that, but he did not seem to be, he seemed to be a child, as if his skin had somehow grown old. He was really very, very bizarre looking. And quite frankly, terrifying. And he would leave these places in the woods where there were hundreds and hundreds of cigarette butts.
Oh, gosh.
And we were once out hiking. We were way back in this woods. We were a couple miles back. It was a big woods owned by the state of New York. And we found one of those places. And we just looked at each other and thought, both of us silently, are we going to get home alive? Mm. Or what? Is he a guardian? Is that why he was so upset about our skinny dipping? Or what is he?
Mm-hmm.
So now I want to, folks, I know you. Some of you say, don't talk so much on the show. But I have to, because frankly, there's no other way to do this.
That's right.
Yeah. But now we've set the scene. You understand that I'm heavily involved in this whole hybrid business.
Mm-hmm.
And I want to know from you exactly what you think it's for. What is going on here?
Oh my gosh, Whitley, I'm asked that so much. I just did a filming the other day and I was asked that, you know, that's always the million-dollar question, and I wish I had a definitive answer. And I tell people, if someone comes up to you and says, I know what this is definitely this and that, and run, because we don't know. I mean, even though we're considered experts and we've been doing this a long time, I just know that, I mean, I've worked with well over 1,000 people, hundreds of hours of regression, and I know that people are shown these babies, and they, time and time again, they are taken again, abducted again, taken aboard the craft, and shown these children during their lifetime when they're adolescents and teenagers and so forth, and they're made to bond with these children.
I want to ask you a question, which is, why are they shown the children? But we have to take a little break for our free Dreamlanders right now. When we get back, be ready for Yvonne and Jim's answers. We'll be right back. Listen to some words from one of our longtime subscribers.
As a subscriber of Dreamland for many years, it's been an incredible adventure and truly a Rosetta Stone for so many of the experiences that all of your listeners have had. Please join us. It's a fantastic ride. But I will say that certainly Dreamland does reflect something that I've always known, that man's mind mirrors a universe that mirrors man's mind. And no other place will you get this truth than on Dreamland. Come join us.
Some of the most thrilling, mind-opening interviews ever recorded are in the Dreamland Archive. Open your mind to Sir Lawrence Gardner's brilliant vision of the past. Listen to Russell Targ's phenomenal insights about ESP. Be inspired by Dr. Eben Alexander's stunning near-death experience. Listen to an actual recording from a plane as it was attacked by a gigantic flying disc. Be transported to a new level of inner grace with Whitley Strieber's meditations. Enjoy The Communion, Transformation, Majestic, Secret School, and Superstorm audiobooks, and so much more. The UnknownCountry.com subscriber section. As little as 10 cents a day. Priceless. Whitley Strieber, one of the great authors of our time. War Day changed the way we think about nuclear war. Communion led millions to realize that they had encountered the visitors. Superstorm gave a word to the world that has become the byword of our time. The Key is among the most prophetic books ever written. And where can you get inside the mind that created all this? On UnknownCountry.com, where Whitley's life stories, his powerful meditations, his books, Communion, Transformation, The Secret School, and others are available in audio format, and so much more exclusive Whitley Strieber material. Join Whitley on the path to tomorrow. How? Subscribe to UnknownCountry.com today.
Yvonne Smith and Jim Lowe, their new book, Chosen. Don't miss Chosen. And Yvonne, can you tell us a little bit about how we know you have a group that meets in somewhere in California. Can you tell us a little bit about it?
Oh, gosh. I founded Close Encounters Resource Organization, the support group, 24 years ago, because I realized that once people left my office after doing a regression, they really had no one to turn to in many instances, not even a spouse, a family member, and certainly not a coworker. So in those days, back in the early 90s, you know, we were barely doing email. So people were calling me, these abductees were calling me, and I could be on the phone 24 hours a day because they needed support. So it started out with six of us in my living room, and I was married at the time. And, you know, I decided, okay, we need to, you know, establish that we're going to meet once a month and it's going to be private. We don't advertise, put out the location, because we want people to feel safe in sharing their experiences. And since then, it's grown where we have people coming in from all over Southern California. And in fact, Whitley, I have people driving in from other states just to attend the meetings. 1 month we will meet in Orange County, and another month, the next month, we will meet up in near the San Fernando Valley, because we have people coming in from all over, and I'm trying to accommodate everyone. This is how widespread this is.
Now, let me ask you this. How would people get in touch with you if they're interested in this work and in perhaps in joining the group?
The best thing to do is email me at Yvonne, my first name, Yvonne, the number 4, PTSD, as in post-traumatic stress disorder, at gmail.com. I get many, many emails each day, and that would be the best way to contact me. Tell me a little bit about what is happening in your life. What have you been going through? Because as we know, we all know, this is a lifelong experience that starts in childhood.
Yeah, that's very true. It does start in childhood. It certainly did for me and for pretty much everybody I know in the experience. You know, before we left the air, I was going to ask a question, which is, why are people shown the children? Why were Anne and I shown the child, the baby? It was a little baby. I don't remember that it looked strange, but it was in the arms of a figure that did look very strange. Can you tell us why you think this part of it is even happening? Because you'd think that if they'd stolen something like this, why would they bring it back to us?
You know, I feel because these babies, these hybrids, need us as humans to bond with them. So many of my clients are told, and John, for instance, who's in my book Chosen, you know, he was told that you must love this child in order for it to survive. You know, and they're all told this is your child, or sometimes there's a sense when the abductee is looking at this baby and he or she realizes, oh my God, I think this is my child. And it's very emotional for men and women to see these children. And later on, it's, you know, interestingly enough, because of our humanness, if that's a word, our human side, and how we bond with each other and our children and our families, the abductees or experiencer, they become very attached to these children. And it breaks their heart when they know they can't bring them back here. I had a very, very emotional session with one of my clients. She's in Chosen, Renee. And during the session, she just was in hysterics crying because they actually took the baby out of her arms. And she kept saying, I want to take her. I want to take her. And they said, you can't take her. You know, she won't survive. And believe me, over the years, Whitley, I mean, I have had to block myself during sessions so that I don't break down and cry, because it's heart-wrenching to watch this from men and women. So I think they want us to know that this program is going on, that these little children are a part of us, and they need us to survive. Now, the ultimate question is, what's going to happen to these children, to these hybrids? You know, they grow up, and where are they? Now, interestingly, you know, doing this for so long, and you probably have heard this too, Whitley, is many people feel that they have met hybrids here walking around among us. So, you know, we're in that next phase. In my first book, Chosen, there was a lady, it was at the end of my chapter, and this was in the 60s, and I believe it was right after Betty and Barney Hill, or right around that time in 61, where she had, which she thought, well, in those days, nobody said hybrid. You know, we didn't have that word at that time, but she feels she met someone that was unusual. She felt that he could read her mind, he could see right through her, and it actually frightened her.
Yeah, they can.
Different.
The one who lived in our woods could read minds very clearly. There's no question about it.
Absolutely.
I think he was so disturbed because I don't think he could turn that off. I think he read minds all the time, whether he wanted to or not. Maybe he was sleep deprived also because of it. Because he used to stay right outside our bedroom in the condo in a little cul-de-sac, and I could feel him reading my mind. I knew he was doing it. I could feel it.
Ugh.
And it was unpleasant because it was like he was trying to, well, there was something a little bit lascivious about it. It was not nice. But I just can't understand. Well, like, for example, where they are, this guy was here and the ones who messed up our cars were here. And some of them are, well, I'll give you an example. The two that were one of the two that were living in the condo, I once walked into the drugstore down the street. This is after I knew they were there and knew who they were. And there was one of them in the drugstore. They smoked constantly. And he was literally piling his arms up with smoking materials, cigarettes, cartons, pipe tobacco, all kinds of stuff like that. And he walked out of the store with all of this stuff in his arms openly without even – he looked at me with this sort of conspiratorial, very sinister look on his face. And none of the clerks noticed him do it.
Interesting.
None of them. So, you know, I keep asking myself, and I'm asking you, what is going on? And we're going to go a little deeper into that in just a minute. We'll be right back.
You've probably heard the music for years. It's the theme song for Dreamland. But you may not know the name of the piece, The O of Pleasure. Or the name of the composer, Ray Lynch. Ray Lynch is a 3-time Billboard Award winner. Ray is also the composer of the platinum album, Deep Breakfast. Pandora calls Ray one of the most influential artists in New Age pop and adult alternative circles. For music that will move your heart and set your spirit soaring, visit www.raylynch.com.
Aloha, Jeremy Vaney here, and I want to tell you about my latest undertaking, OurUndoing.com. OurUndoing.com is a multimedia website where if you watch, if you read, if you listen, without trying to absorb knowledge like we do with normal learning, and without the normal judgmental filters that we use to compare and contrast so-called spiritual knowledge, if we watch, if we read, if we listen, without all of that, we may just wake up to our full human nature. That is what this website is for. It's not about what we're doing, it's about who we are, truly are, when we're off the pendulum of duality. If your life is about seeking truth above all else, look no further. Join me at OurUndoing.com.
Jim, I'd like to know your impressions of this. When did you start working with Yvonne, and how do the two of you work together?
I started in about near the end of 2013, but really got involved more in 2014. And just joined the group. I'd been pretty much keeping my experiences sort of, as Al Gore talked about, in a lockbox off to the side for decades. And I finally couldn't keep it locked up anymore. And so I looked around and read a lot of books on things and saw that Yvonne's approach is the one that I appreciated the most, because she wasn't out there telling everyone what the answer was, as she said earlier. And so I joined the group and instantly felt at home. It was like I met a bunch of relatives I'd never seen before and was very comfortable with it. And so I've been working with the group and helping out ever since.
So, and what exactly do you do, if I may ask?
I'm an attorney.
I mean in the group.
Pardon?
Yeah, your outside life. Yeah, we mentioned that earlier, I think. But in the group?
Well, mostly I'm just a regular member. And but I've helped Yvonne on some logistical matters with the group, and because I tend to do that within my practice.
You're an organizing.
Organizing
skills,
that kind of stuff.
Now,
and
what?
I was originally just going to edit this book, and things happened, and all of a sudden I'm writing part of the book. And it was mostly Yvonne's work, but I helped out a lot, and it was interesting while we were doing it. It was a real push to get it done.
What
we have to get this done now, you know.
Yeah, and we'll talk about that sense of urgency in the second half hour, because that's a very important part of all of this for all of us. We're all feeling it. The next question I have is, and if you don't are not ready to answer this, I respect that completely, but could you tell us why you came to Yvonne in the first place? What experiences did you bring?
Well, I've had experiences pretty much my whole life. I don't consider myself unique. I'm sort of a standard issue experiencer, starting at age 5 and through my teenage years. Pretty heavy involvement, 20s, 30s, and 40s. Pretty much all my life I've had experiences, and most of which have been, I don't have a lot of conscious memories of being on the ships, but I know I've had the before and after. And one time I found myself on my front porch in, I think it was 1998, and bathed in a bright, intense sun-like light that didn't touch anything else around me. And when I came consciously awake, the first thing I said was out loud, "So that's what they look like." And the next morning, I woke up and had an equilibrium problem, and I had ended up basically being unable to stand up, and had vertigo for 2 weeks and couldn't drive or do anything. And
oh, my goodness.
Then I later had two 4-inch scars on my forehead that weren't there before, and looked at other pictures of myself before. And, they don't run the same direction as my wrinkles. And I was working with Yvonne just about 2 years ago, and was trying to regress back to get some of the information about that. And then I go home, and I just finished a book, and I needed to. So I went to my library and figured I'd read some book I had put down before. And I picked up a copy of Anne's and your book, Communion Letters. And I had a bookmark of a receipt in there, and I had bought it in 1997. And so I started reading from that point. And the next story in the book was someone that had a similar procedure that had written you an letter about it. And so that was rather chilling to have it happen the day or two after I had been regressed on that same subject. And so there was a boomerang type thing that opened my skin up and then closed it again.
Yeah, and those synchronicities like that make it seem like there's a level of design or direction in this whole thing that we can't quite see, but it's there.
It is.
Well, So now here you are, and it must be, I hope it's fulfilling work. And by the way, before we leave the first half hour, do you all have any way of getting to you on the internet directly, like a web page or anything?
I have a Facebook page set up, and also on the Zero International website, I believe we did set up a contact page.
Okay, so there's a Zero International website.
Right. It's, right now, we've taken the year off of bringing in speakers and hosting an event. Because it's a huge undertaking. One of the other ways we're trying to spread the word. But as I mentioned, and I'm going to be adding on a blog to that website. And it's still under construction, but I think the best way to contact me directly is by email. And then I could get right back to everyone.
Yeah. And the email address will be on the show page, folks. So you can, if you want to contact Yvonne, you can just go and click on that and you can contact her. Now we've come to the end of the first half hour of Dreamland, and free Dreamlanders, especially if you're a Close Encounter witness, you should definitely subscribe and support the site so that we can keep going and you can listen to more of this, because we have to do this so that we will get you curious enough to subscribe. That's the whole idea. Yvonne Smith and Jim Lowe's new book, Chosen, From the Alien Hybrid Program to the Fate of the Planet. It's an important book. It will give you extraordinary insight into this experience. And in the second half of the show, we're going to talk more about some specific cases in the book and try to kind of get under the skin of this whole experience, and especially where it's going, because I'm not alone among Close Encounter witnesses by any means in feeling a real sense of urgency. So subscribers, stay with us. Free Dreamlanders, as always, thank you for listening.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by UnknownCountry.com and its family of subscribers. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host. And I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander. Thank you for listening.